Welcome to the how-to video on NetIQ's radius rules. What are radius rules? The radius options policy allows for the defining of rules using regular expressions to accomplish various actions. There are four basic rule types that can be configured: input rules, chain and event selection rules, and result specification rules. With these rules, we can leverage radius attributes sent from the client. We can select a specific chain or event based on attributes such as the NAS identifier or the IP address of the radius client. We can even modify the results sent back to the client from the radius server. Let's take a brief look now at how we can use these rules to help us. Okay, so let's take a quick look at radius input rules. I've got my advanced authentication environment here. I'm going to go down and select radius options. And I'm going to see the various rules here. So I got input rules, event and chain selections. I got my result specifications. And you can see at the bottom, I got a client list. So I have a few clients in my lab environment set up. And those are obviously going to be required in order for Radius to establish a communication between the client and the Radius server hosted within the advanced authentication product. It's also important to note that I've already enrolled my account with a password or a PIN and also a hardware token. All right, let's quickly look at these input rules. And so I've got two input rules here. And what I've done is I've created these input rules. I'll show you one of them in more detail here. And this is looking at the target attributes, the password, and it's going to be the same on the source side. The regular expression is basically just split in this string. And this first portion is going to go as parameter number one to the result specifications. And essentially what I'm doing here is I'm taking the PIN in the first rule, and in the second rule, I'm taking the OTP. All right, and so what we're doing is there's oftentimes these radius applications, these legacy applications that only have the ability to do a single credential, right? It's typically username and password, and that's all they can do. Well, what if we want to enforce multi-factor authentication for those use cases? Well, we can do that with this. We can allow the user to enter a PIN, for example, or password in combination to a one-time password from a hardware token. And these input rules will parse out those two values from the combined string. Let me go ahead and show you how this works real quick. So I've got a little radius utility here. I'm going to, in the password field, I'm going to type my user's PIN. I'm going to generate my six-digit OTP. I'm going to type that in next. And I'm using a NAS identifier for VPN to map to the specific event. And we'll talk about that here in a minute. But I'm going to go ahead and send that to the server now. And advanced authentication is going to parse those out for me, and it's going to, you'll see it'll accept it. There we go. It took a couple seconds here, but we see access accepted. So it took that string, and because of these input rules, it took, basically what this is doing is looking at the last six digits and always using that as the OTP. The OTP is a fixed length, so I can use that type of regular expression to say everything prior to the last six digits becomes my PIN or my password, whatever knowledge factor I'm passing, and then the last six digits is always going to be applied to the OTP. And so I was able to satisfy a chain assigned to the VPN event with multi-factor authentication here, even though I only sent the Radius server one single string. And that's where these input rules really come in handy for that type of scenario. So that's just one use case, but that's a real powerful one that I think everybody can benefit from, especially if you have older legacy applications floating around that leverage Radius. So it allows you to do MFA with applications that otherwise could not support it. All right, let's jump back to the policies here and quickly look at event and chain selection. So you kind of got a glimpse of the event selection one already with that NAS identifier going to the radius or going to the VPN event here. So I've selected VPN as, or I set select a VPN as my NAS identifier attribute. And because of that, when the engine runs here, it sees the NAS identifier with the VPN value, it assigns it to or maps it to the VPN event in the back end. So every time I send that NAS identifier for VPN, I know I'm gonna hit this event. And this is really helpful because we wanna be able to separate and split out all the various use cases and map them to their individual events. This makes troubleshooting and configuration a lot easier, right? We can customize events and either input rules or even chains and methods that are required to authenticate to that event. And we can do all that based on this NAS identifier. Now, you also could assign IP addresses. If you have a fixed server or a fixed virtual appliance or maybe a hardware appliance of some sort that is going to authenticate to advanced authentication, you could also use an IP address or various other attributes. This is really, really flexible. But these are just a few ways that we use this on a day-to-day basis. You also can have chain selection rules here, and the NAS identifier rule you see here is basically like a default catch-all, right? If there's no NAS identifier presented in the authentication request in the Radius packet, then go ahead and assign it to the Radius logon event. And that might be a default one that has your most common or basic chain that you're going to authenticate users with. But you can do so much here with this. You can do chain selection. So if you have a certain group of users, you want to have a specific chain applied to them, you can do something with that here. The result specification is a little more complicated. That's going to allow you to manipulate the output and the result sent back to the Radius client from the server. And we really don't have time to get into that today, but I wanted to show you guys at least this input rule and how you could split that single value into multiples, because I think that's a really common use case for older legacy applications still leveraging Radius. And of course, event selection is huge, because otherwise, without the event selection rules, everything basically defaults to one Radius event in your backend. And really, we want granularity for operational support, troubleshooting. It's a lot easier if each use case has its own event. So I hope this was a help to you guys. And thank you for watching this video. For more information about the Advanced Authentication platform, or to see a demo, please reach out to us via info@mtrix.com or by phone at 864-704-4691.